So it's very interesting how life happens the way to bring you to where you're supposed to be when you're ready to show up, right? So previously, I just wasn't ready to show up. I had my own stuff to deal with, my own baggage, my own issues, my own things that I had to get over, my own anger, my own, you know, whatever, that I had to be willing to let go. But you have to be willing to set those down so you can pick something else up. So it all showed up when I was ready for that. When somebody says to me, because of you, I believed I could do it, and this wouldn't have happened if I hadn't met you, that is magical for me. Knowing that everything I went through, everything I had to learn, all the tough lessons I had to crawl through were all worth it, if somebody else is able to say, I changed this because you made me believe I could.
And folks, if there's one thing you know about me, it's that I'm real. Any product that I endorse, I actually use, and Save Around is one of them. This product is so incredible, and if you don't have a Save Around book, you have to get one because it's things you do every day. No matter where you live in the country, they're in over 160 markets. They have a mobile app as well, but basically what it is you get discounts and offers to all your favorite places that you're going to each and every week. So whether it's grabbing something quick, or if you're going out to dinner, even heading to a sporting goods store, going on vacation, renting a car, Save Around has offers for you. And what's great about these books is they're valid for an entire year. So go to saveround.com, put in the coupon code American, and you will receive a very special offer that is not available anywhere else. So do yourself and your family a favor, grab a Save Around book, save some money. They make excellent gifts, especially during the holiday season. So go to saveround.com and purchase your book today. On this week's episode of American Real, we bring you serial entrepreneur and holistic health coach, Sarah Hubbard, whose amazing life journey includes rising up from an early abusive household, overcoming an automobile accident, and eventually excelling in life, all from which Sarah attributes to reading books, one of which is called Letting Go of Your Bananas. Sarah and I go deep in her story as the queen of tough love provides insights from how she parents to her coaching style, her business with her spouse, and her motivational speaking. Sarah's journey to being a guest on American Real all started from her joining our live tribe and inner circle groups, which she has demonstrated excellence and where she provides our group a taste of her coaching abilities. The doors for live tribe and inner circle are open, and we encourage you to close out 2018 strong as we head into a new year. Join our group of high achievers who push each other to become their best selves. Click on the links below and start today. And now, without further ado, I bring to you Sarah Hubbard.
This is American Real. I am Roger Brooks. My guest today is Sarah Hubbard, a recent graduate of the Live Tribe, and you're also part of our Inner Circle group. Sarah, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much, Roger. I'm so glad to be here.
We connected a couple of months ago, which was great, through a mutual friend,
Yes.
Pika. And Pika's connected us with a lot of people from your group and other groups around the world, really.
Right.
And we hit it off from the start.
Absolutely.
And you joined our live tribe.
Mm-hmm.
And for people who don't know what the live tribe is, can you talk about your experience with it?
Mm-hmm.
How you got actually the courage to get started,
mm-hmm.
and then your experience for the first 21 days of that 21-day challenge.
Right. So the Live Tribe is a private group on Facebook where you go live for 60 seconds or less every single day for a consecutive 21 days. And so then once you hit the first round of 21 days, then you enter the next cycle of 21 days. But they have to be consecutive days and 60 seconds or less. So as somebody who had been going live for a long time on Facebook for my coaching business, the challenge for me was 60 seconds or less. because I tend to hit the 3-minute range, so that was a little difficult. But it also gave me a safe place to talk about my personal life, talk about things growing up, all the things that make me the person who I am today. And that's not something that I normally just open up or share, but I was able to do so because it's a private community and a safe space.
Yeah, great. And I believe you're still in the group now.
Yep.
You've completed, I think, your second cycle.
Correct.
And now you're able to go into our Take 5 group, which is 3 to 5 minutes,
right?
Which is more of
my
what you're used
spot.
To.
Yes. Right?
So I look forward to seeing you there. But I guess for people that don't know what it is or are thinking about it,
mm-hmm.
What advice do you have for
my advice is if you've ever considered speaking with people, if you're ever trepidatious about having a conversation, meeting somebody new, do the challenge, because it opens up all of those avenues. It'll help you speak more smoothly. It'll help you be better with your delivery, be more concise, because you have such a short time to get out what you want to say. It'll help you open your range of topics. You'll probably start reading more because you're going to need more to talk about. And I would say it's only makes you better, so there's no loss.
Great. Yeah, and for you, you were used to going live.
Mm-hmm.
So now you're trying this new group, 60-second time frame.
Mm-hmm.
But did you learn anything different than before going through this challenge?
I learned to get to the point quicker. I learned to really have to think out what I'm going to say. I made a list of my topics so that I stayed on track. I wanted to go in a chronological order, or what was the most significant to who I am today, in that kind of order, and I had to get it out very quickly, very concisely, get it done. And I think it has made me better for my goal-getter lives, because now I'm more focused there too because of going through that process.
Awesome. Yeah, and that was my next question, actually. Does it help in any other areas of your life?
Mm-hmm.
How about just in life in general, aside from your professional life? Any impact on your personal life?
Yes, because I've met people I would have never met. I love Carolyn Williams. I always catch hers. I don't know her, but I always catch them, and I find she's always bringing challenges to us or always bringing topics, and I really enjoy that because then I'm able to maybe have a conversation about something that I wasn't even thinking about, but that I'm aware of and also focused on.
And how great is that? The technology we have today at our fingertips allows us to connect with people virtually all over the world. You form these friendships, and it's really incredible.
Right.
And the fact that we're sitting here together today is living proof of that.
Right, exactly.
So great. So let's get into your story.
Okay.
Because that's why we're really here. And I would say from reading your bio,
mm-hmm.
you didn't have a quite a normal or typical upbringing, correct?
Correct.
So tell us about, as far back as you want to go, tell us about your upbringing,
mm-hmm.
and how you came into your career that is just incredible.
Okay.
From where you started.
Okay, so I'm an only child. My parents planned me. They can tell you the day they got they conceived me, because that's how planned I was. They were divorced by the time I was 3. They had adopted a son who was 15, who had cystic fibrosis, so they always knew he would die before you know, he would not go long into his life. But they didn't want to have more biological children because there was so many kids who needed homes. And then, like I said, they divorced when I was three. So it all fell apart quickly. At that point, from a kid's point of view, you know, I just lived my kid life. You know, we had this, my grandparents, my parents, her sister, we all belonged to a country club. I was a country club brat at that point, originally from Michigan. So you have this very charmed life. So, you know, I played tennis at three, and we had a pool and 2 acres of land and, you know, everything you could ever want to have. And then once my parents split up, that all kind of disintegrated quickly. So my mom was dating a guy who was very abusive, very into drugs. I had been going to a gifted school, so there's a school in Michigan called Roper. You have to test to go into it, and you take courses based on your ability, not your age or grade. Like, grades don't exist, they're levels. So you test into the level, and at three, I was taking science with 7 and 8 year olds. So I was on track. I would have graduated by the age 13 if I had stayed in that private school. So that's a little different too, because when you're a little smarter or, you know, more advanced, you're very aware when things aren't right. And he was a really horrible man. Like, and now as a grown woman, I can only even try to imagine how my mother felt as a grown woman at that point. And I'm more understanding of the different stages she went through, or, you know, why she drank and things like that. I mean, you know, you can't experience pretty much torture and not, you know, go through those changes of trying to hide from whatever it is you're experiencing. But that said, I ended up getting pulled out of the private school because he didn't want me to go there. He wanted to leave. He was, like I said, extremely abusive. He wanted to keep me around because then they could get money out of my grandparents and my father to keep living, to keep moving, etc. We ended up that whole trek, and I don't know how long it lasted because I was little, so I really don't have a concept of. I know I had birthdays. I know, like, I had a birthday. I got older, but I ended up being put on a plane by myself and sent back to Michigan when the money ran out. So,
with your grandparents?
My father sent the plane ticket. He met me at the airport, and then my maternal grandmother and my father ended up with joint custody of me. But I lived with my maternal grandmother primarily, and my father would have me on the weekends.
I see. So then what happens? You how long did you stay with them?
Again, I was little, so I kind of don't really have a concept of how long. I mean, I would be with my grandmother during the week. I would be with my father on the weekends. My mother was still just gone at this point. And then I remember when she showed back up, I was scared because I didn't understand that, you know, it was this man who was really pulling the strings. I just knew they had taken me from my comfort zone and this charmed existence that I had. And so I ran from her, but then we had to do counseling, and then my grandparents maintained custody of me with my father having joint custody, but my mother lived and moved into the house with us. So when I was in first grade, we were all in the same house. That I can tell you. But like the actual time frames, I don't know. I was just too little.
So then fast forward. So you know, you're growing up,
mm-hmm.
you go through high school, and I understand you excelled right through your senior year.
I did and I didn't. So when I was eight, My mom had met a man who moved to upstate New York, because that's where, so it was from upstate New York. He was working in Michigan at the time. And they wanted to get married, so we ended up moving to Oneonta so she could marry him and be with him. And then when I was 16, there was a car accident with my car. I actually wasn't driving it, even though I said I was driving it at the time. And they hydroplaned and landed out into a shaved cornfield. So 400 feet in the air, they went 400 feet out, 50 feet up off the embankment. And my mom didn't answer the phone when I called because she was drunk on the couch. She was passed out on the couch, so she didn't hear me calling to say, I need someone to come get me, I'm stuck, whatever. And the next day, she was so upset by the fact that, you know, choosing to have, you know, drink and go out caused her to not be there for me. She chose to go to rehab at that point. So then I ended up living on my own. My stepfather threw me out the night before she left to go. I drove her to rehab. I used to go do the family counseling with her, whatever. And then I ended up living on my own, pretty much. Like, I would stay with friends, I would stay here, but I wasn't going to school. So the whole first half of my junior year, I didn't go to school, pretty much. I mean, I did, but I didn't go to school. And I called my father and I said, I can't stay here because I'm not going to school. I'm not going to graduate. I cannot do it on my own. So for the first time in all the years I had lived here, for the past 8 years, he finally came to New York State. And then I went with him. And then I caught up, and I did pretty well that year, but I had to catch up. Like, I had to pretty much get enough credits in half a year to make sure I still was on track to graduate high school. Luckily, I had started my Regents classes, my high school classes in eighth grade. Otherwise, that wouldn't have happened. And then I had a falling out with my stepmother, so I ended up going to my maternal grandparents' house, which meant then I went to another high school my senior year. And yes, I did well there. I had a very structured life there. You know, I had a curfew. We ate dinner together every day. You know, I was back to normalcy. Yes. So letting go of your bananas really has like a really long subtitle. It's like how to be more successful in your life by getting rid of everything rotten, I think is the second piece of that, but I'm not 100% sure. I was doing the body shop at home at the time. It doesn't exist anymore, but it was like one of the best things ever. I loved the body shop products, you know, the store in the mall. And then when they created the at-home division, I was like, this is a no-brainer. I just wanted the discount. I had no plans on making a business out of it. But I did really well, and I ended up growing within that business really quickly. And my upline leader had like an idea of a lot of the stuff that was going on with me, with my younger kid's father and stuff. So she was like, she sent me the book as a gift. And the book is really about why you got to let go of everything rotten in your life and how to determine what's rotten and what's not.
So what were some of the things it talked about?
relationships that don't serve you. That's really what it's all about. It's all about relationships and habits that don't serve you, why they keep you where you're at, you know, how one rotten banana spoils the whole bunch, so you have to cut it out. You have to change those choices. And that was the beginning of my aha moment. And that's when I really insisted that, like, his father and I had nothing to do with each other. He got out of the house. And ironically, my mom had gifted me Harmonic Wealth like that same year. But it would sit in the bathroom. I would read it once in a while. I mean, you have kids. I don't know. Your wife probably could relate more to this, but your kids try to go everywhere with you. So the bathroom was like the only place I could sit and get 2 minutes to myself to read or whatever. But I was really just like a page at a time if I was lucky, because then they're banging on the door looking for you to be available again. And then when we moved to Long Island in 2010, but my kids had 8 weeks of school left in Queens. So we drove back and forth every day. For me to bring them to school, but I just stayed in Queens. I was like, I'm not going to drive them back and forth four times in one day. And I would read the book. I would go sit in Astoria Park at the track and read the book. And that was really, like, there's lots of lessons in it. There's lots of things that you're supposed to do. So there's scripts, and you're supposed to actively, like, change the words, fix this. But the biggest lesson that I think anyone could learn from that book, forget all that, because, you know, it's very much based on like the magic in every book in the world that you could read on it. And he literally gives you a list of 27 books you should read that he read, that he even came to all these realizations. But the number one thing that he said that I've never read in any other book but this book is, you know the saying, you should treat others how you want to be treated? He says, forget that. Treat yourself how you expect other people to treat you, because you set the bar. So if you don't treat you well, and you don't believe in you, and you don't love you, neither can anyone else.
I like that. I've never heard that before.
Right.
Yeah. So it sounds like this book came into your life at the right time.
It definitely came into my life at the right time. It was like the one piece of advice missing from everything. And it helped me shift all my relationships, helped me shift my perspective and how I dealt with people. Because, you know, I have very little patience. And, you know, my nickname is Sassy, and that's not for no reason. Because I'm definitely a tell it like it is, straight shooter. My one girlfriend would tell you she used to come around the corner to talk to me when she knew she needed the gut punch of the truth. But that said, I will do anything for anybody that I genuinely love if they need help, even if I'm not happy with what they're doing. However, when you get this piece of advice, you stop making excuses for other people and you say, wait a minute, I really have to be the priority, and everything else becomes secondary. Your kids, your spouse, everything.
And has it served you well?
Very well, yeah. It's what allows me to walk away with peace. If a relationship is not the healthiest or not the happiest, or if it jeopardizes my peace at all, I may love you from a distance, but that doesn't mean I have to talk to you. Mm.
Yeah, I've never heard it put that way, and I think it makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
So you've been on an entrepreneurial path from a young age.
Very young. Mm-hmm.
So talk about that.
So we talked about the fact that I was moved to Michigan when I was 8, and I was used to getting whatever I wanted, whenever I wanted it, didn't even have to ask, many situations just laid it right out for me. So it was a very shocking situation to go from living like that to living in a house with other family members in a very small space and whatnot. And, I was like, well, I want to do this. Well, I want to do that. Well, not to mention the fact I literally burst into tears when I moved to Oneonta, because I was used to being from this major metropolis. And I was like, where did you bring me? So I would want money to do stuff. And my stepfather's sister, my aunt, I went to her, and she sold Avon. And I said, if I deliver your orders, will you pay me? She said, yes. And then she said, oh, and you can bring, after I did it successfully the first time, right? I said, well, people asked for the lipstick. Oh, did you have the lipstick? So then she would send me with samples. And if I got another order, I got paid for that too. Now we're talking, I got like 50 cents per delivery and like 25 cents per order. But I was 8. That was enough at that point. You know, they still had 5-cent candy at that point. So right. That was enough for me to go to the local little store on my bike with my basket in the front, which is how I delivered the orders, and go buy whatever I wanted. And then from there, it just continued. You know, I started babysitting at 11, used to babysit my next door neighbor's kids, again, like 50 cents. But we're also talking minimum wage at that point was probably like $2.20. So
it's all relative.
It was all relative, yeah. Exactly. And then when I was 11, I wanted to continue dance lessons. And my parents didn't have the money, so I went to the dance teacher and said, if I teach dance classes, can I take them? She said, yes. So I taught in exchange to take dance classes. And then I wanted to get my hair frosted. Do you remember that phase?
Sure.
So I wanted my hair frosted, and my mother said, absolutely not. I'm not paying for that. And I said, well, I want to get it done. And she said, well, if you can figure out how to pay for it. So I told my hairdresser, and him and his wife owned the salon together. And he said, well, we need a babysitter on Saturdays so we could both be at the salon. So if you babysit for us every week, I could get. So I think I was the only 12-year-old.
Bartering.
At that point, getting my, well, I got my hair done every week.
Right. Oh, my gosh.
So I not only got it frosted, but they had like these masks and stuff they would do for my hair. And I got my hair done every week. Thought it was great. Seemed like a good deal to me.
So you had the entrepreneurial bug.
Mm-hmm. Well, I had the determination to not be told no.
So you figured out a way
to get what I want.
Yeah.
Right.
Interesting. So how does that play into some of the things you're doing today? So I know you became a health coach, holistic health coach.
Yep.
And then a personal trainer. So bring us up to date.
Yeah, so those two things I actually did for myself, ironically. I came across health coaching accidentally. I have polycystic ovary syndrome. I've always battled with my weight since I was young. You know, I joke, but it's almost real. Like if I breathe too hard, I can gain weight, which is very real when you have polycystic ovary syndrome and are insulin resistant. So it's a battle. It's an uphill battle. And, you know, I would have to work out for many hours and weight train a lot to lose the same weight somebody who has a normal metabolism could lose in a shorter period of time. And my doctor and I had a huge fight because she was like, why aren't you losing any more weight? And I was like, I don't know. And she said, well, I'm going to send you for a bariatric consult. So I was naive. I had never heard it referred to like that. So I was like, what is that? And she said, stomach surgery. I said, no, I didn't do that at my heaviest. I didn't do that when I was 298 pounds. So now that I'm a size 12 and 200 pounds, I'm not going to do that. She said, well, you're going to have no other choice because you're just not losing. And I got so enraged and so furious. I told you, whenever I'm told no, it sparks something in me. And I went home and I started Googling. And I was Googling to find food systems or advice on polycystic ovary syndrome, how to eat for that. And I found that, but because I was Googling so much nutrition info, an ad popped up for the Institute for Integrative Nutrition. And I was like, what's this? And you know, I've always been that person everybody comes to for advice, comes to for information, comes to find out how to do something. So I've always been coaching. Right? I just didn't know that that's what I was doing. So what's really beautiful about the program that Institute for Integrative Nutrition has is a few things. One, it's a full year-long program and really a year and a half because the next 6 months is all about building your business. It's partnered with SUNY Purchase, so you get continuing ed credits. It also can be applied towards a bachelor's degree if that's what you want to do. They've partnered with colleges for that. But what's the best part about it is that their coaching practice is based on what they call primary foods and secondary foods. So your primary foods are the four major aspects of your life, your relationships, your career, your spirituality, and your physical activity. And you work on fixing those first because your secondary foods are actually the foods that go into your body. And if you don't fix the primary foods, it won't matter how you eat. So,
is that when it all clicked?
well, you know, I had already been on this path, right? So it's very interesting how life happens the way to bring you to where you're supposed to be when you're ready to show up, right? So previously, I just wasn't ready to show up. I had my own stuff to deal with, my own baggage, my own issues, my own things that I had to get over, my own anger, my own, you know, whatever, that I had to be willing to let go. You know, like Erykah Badu's song, Bag Lady, you got to put down those bags. You have to be willing to set those down so you can pick something else up. So it all showed up when I was ready for that. And because of how their program is built, even though you're technically, now it's no longer called Holistic Health Coach, now they have named it a Health and Life Coach, because that's really what you're trained to do. Okay. And you focus much more on the primary foods than you do the secondary foods. And so I did that for myself and also became a personal trainer because trainers aren't trained to understand people who have issues like polycystic ovary syndrome, metabolic syndrome. They don't, so they will accuse you of not eating what you're told to eat because they don't realize that you need it tweaked different. It's not just calories in, calories out for you.
Mm. And the primaries that you talked about,
mm-hmm.
I find that fascinating. Again, I mean, it makes sense because I've never heard it put that way, but
right.
It really makes sense. If you could figure those things out as best you can, mm-hmm. then I would think naturally the foods that we put into our body, you know, we become naturally more mindful of that.
It's not even just what we put in. So physiologically, right? So our brains are what control our thoughts, our moods, our hormone release, etc., right? But our stomach is the brain for the processing of all of that, the nutrients that have to keep us sustaining and rolling. So if your brain and your stomach are not firing together because something is out of whack and you're putting too much energy over here because this is stressing you out, so now you're not really handling things well, it all is wrapped up together.
That makes sense. So you lost how much weight?
Over 100 pounds. I worked really, really hard to do that. In 2014, I hit my lowest weight ever. I was like 170, 169 pounds. When I reached that, so, you know, people hear numbers and people are unrealistic all the time about how much people really weigh, right? So, you know, they have this idea in their mind, well, women should be like 110 pounds, but it's all relative. So when I was like 169, 170 pounds, I was a size 6, and this is pre-tummy tuck, still with all this extra skin. People would say to me, I think that's good. I think you need to pump the brakes and stop. And I did, and then I got busy. I took on a job at a gym because at one point I had wanted to open my own gym. So I was like, the best way to learn it is to work at a gym. So I'd gotten a job at a New York sports club as a sales associate. But those are a lot of hours, a long hours. So it became harder to maintain that because even though I could work out at work, I couldn't work out for the same blocks of time that I could work out prior to doing that. And so I put on a little bit of weight, and then my son was getting ready to leave for the Marines, which was causing some emotional stress, so I didn't have my emotions in check, and I put on a little more weight. But I also had my tummy tuck scheduled for that year. So I still went ahead, because the doctor was like, you really only put on a little bit of weight, you know, there's a lot of skin to remove, so let's, you know, take the skin off and see if we can get you more comfortable. The irony behind all of that is, they say, oh, in 6 weeks you're fine. You're not fine. You know, they cut the skin from here, so just this far below, and they stretch it out and they reattach it down here, and the scar is hip to hip, and they suture all your muscles together to bring them back, especially if you've had kids, so they bring everything back in. And everything hurts. If you cough, it hurts. If you eat just a little bit more than you should, that hurts, because everything is pressure. You cannot lift weights that, well, and I already told you, when you have polycystic ovaries, you have to lift weights. So if I can't lift weights, I'm putting on weight. So then I put weight back on, and then now finally this year, so we're talking, that was May 2015, finally this year, the beginning of this year, I could finally start to do a full sit-up. I could actually go to a kickboxing class. I could actually, you know, do those things, and then I had a horrible car accident in January. But now I'm finally able to work out the way that I need to get my body the fittest. So I don't really focus on the scale. I focus on the inches and how fit I feel I look.
But it took 3 years.
It took 3 years.
Wow. So, tell us about your personal health scare. This accident, right?
Oh, yeah, in January. So in January, I was driving to pick my daughter up. I was on my way home from work. My mother was supposed to pick my daughter up from the basketball game. I said, oh, well, I'm right near the house. I'll just go to the high school and pick her up from the game she was there watching. And I was, you know the statistic, how many accidents happen less than 2 miles from the house? I was blocks, like it's a place I would walk to. So I was, I had the right of way. I had no stop sign. At the time, I was driving a Toyota Corolla. The guy who had a stop sign blew his stop sign in a Toyota Tundra. Came straight through. Luckily, I saw him out of the corner of my eye, so I drove into the street so that he wouldn't just catch me flush. Mm-hmm. And so he ended up catching my back passenger door, but he still sent me spinning and flying, and I landed in a snowbank backwards. It's probably the scariest accident I've been in other car accidents, but that was probably the scariest. I was grateful all the snow hadn't melted yet. It was like the Thursday after that huge snowstorm we had in January. So I was so grateful that they hadn't plowed, because unlike upstate where they plan, in Long Island they don't do that. So you live with snow around for a long time. Mm-hmm. They kind of just let it melt. But I was grateful. So for the first time, I was grateful for these 4-foot snowbanks that were much further into the street, because it stopped me, because I was in the block that leads to the main street, which is not called Main Street, but going backwards. Mm. And a lady stopped and put her car in front of mine so no one would come along and hit me. And she called the police, and the young guy who was in the car, he was in his 20s, he was like, oh my God, I'm sorry, I didn't see you. And I was like, you didn't stop. You just didn't stop.
So what were your injuries?
So my shoulder was really inflamed. Thank God it wasn't fractured or dislocated or anything, but I did have a half cortisone shot. I couldn't even sign my name or type with my right hand, like that's how painful it was, and I'm a righty, of course. My neck, I had 3 vertebrae out of place in my neck, 2 in my mid-back.
And that was this past year?
This January.
This year. Mm-hmm. So you're coming back strong.
I'm coming back strong, yes.
Let's talk about your journey as an entrepreneur.
Okay. Realizations,
the lessons, how your business has grown, these type of things.
Right. So 2011 is when I started my coaching journey. And that's when I started coaching. And I primarily health coached. I'll be honest, I find that very frustrating because people are not always really ready to show up. They show up because they have a wedding to go to. They show up because their friend lost 30 pounds. They show up because they don't necessarily really show up ready to make those changes. It's like the one area of our life where primarily we don't push maybe as hard as we should, right? It's the thing that always takes a back seat.
Right.
So I found it very frustrating to continue just focusing on health coaching. So I decided to kind of go a different way with it. And I started taking on more life coaching type situations. And then through all my business experience, and I always say I'm the worst employee that ever walked. Like I will walk out of a job if you aggravate me that day and not care and shrug my shoulders. And everyone's like, how do you quit jobs like that? I'm like, because I don't care and I can have another one tomorrow. They don't care. So, but that said, I've had lots of experience in lots of different fields, which has helped me build the career I have because I'm super organized. I hate things taking a long period of time, so I'm extra efficient. I can plan something down to a T. I can figure out how long it should really take, and that's just the way my brain works. Like, I'm just a natural problem solver. So I started being an efficiency expert for businesses. Mm. And that inadvertently happened. I was at a company that sold SEO packages, and when I would go in and train them how to use their SEO package to make it actually work for them, and they would say, oh, well, this is what I normally do. And I'd say, why would you do that? Like, why don't you just do da-da-da-da-da? They were like, because I didn't think of it like that. And then it just, they were like, can I hire you to help me fix my systems? And then, and it just was naturally born. And I liked that a lot more. It felt more rewarding. It was more instant gratification, so to speak, because they would implement it. It's their bottom line. It's their pocket. They're not dragging their feet. They're not giving me 20,000 excuses why they can't.
Right.
And I will still health coach people if they're doing it with a group of friends, so they have built-in accountability. But if they're not, I won't. I just won't do it. But so the efficiency expert, the organization piece, that's like my sweet spot. That's where I love to live. I love to problem solve. Lucky for me, I've had some really great jobs that trained me in fields that most people are not even aware of. Like, I'm fully aware of UCAC regulations, so I'm really good at helping write a policy and procedure manual because I know how to keep you from paying unemployment. stuff like that, that, you know, you really can't pay for that kind of stuff.
Yeah. So walk us through an example of what a client might need.
So usually they're not making as much money as they think they should, or they think their employees are terrible. And that's usually not the case. They usually have bad policies, bad, you know, the way things happen, right? So let's say we go into a building shop, so to speak, right? And you gather the wood, but then you bring that wood to somebody else who then cuts the wood, who's then going to bring the wood back to you. So then you stack the wood, and then you take the stack wood, and now you're going to bring it to the guy who's actually going to build the thing, and then he brings it back to you so you can organize that to bring it to somebody. Why? But that's the kind of thing businesses do, right? So it touches too many hands for unnecessary reasons. That's usually what's going on. They have no system in place for their filing. They have no easy, simple place that if someone didn't have an answer to something, they could walk over and grab a book or hit a button and find the file, stuff like that. Like, people should be able to be efficient. They shouldn't have to wait an hour for someone to get out of a meeting to ask a question so they can continue doing what they're doing.
So your job is you go in and you look at the business, look at their areas of weakness, and try to find efficiencies?
Yes. And streamline their process, find out if their employees aren't happy, why they aren't happy, find out why they think their employees are so terrible.
And right? How long do these relationships last?
Depends. It all depends. It can be a one-shot deal. Like I can go in and really just give the advice and give my plan. It could be ongoing. If I have to write a whole policy and procedure manual, that's going to be ongoing. All of my coaching programs, whether it's personal, business related, transitionally, you know, whatever that looks like for somebody, they all run on 90-day cycles. Because it takes 21 days to create a habit and 90 days to create a lifestyle. So you don't know if something really works until it's happened for 90 days. Doing it for 2 weeks is not long enough to know whether or not this actually works.
Mm. I like that 21-day mark.
Yeah.
We know about that.
Right.
That's very interesting. And then on the personal level as a life coach, what are you doing there to help individuals?
For me, it's all the same thing. Believe
it or
not.
Whether
it's a business, it's all the same thing. We do an assessment. What are you not happy about? Why are you not happy? Unfortunately, what I have found, what I have learned from going through everything I went through, you know, in my 20s, I did a lot of finger pointing and I was never doing this. And we talked about off camera how like that 32 to 35 year mark in your life is like that real, hey, stupid, it's you.
Right.
So
where you start taking ownership.
Ownership, yeah. Right. And so my primary thing all the time with everybody is everything is a choice. Everything is a choice and you can only control you. So once you accept you can only control you and everything is a choice, you can go anywhere. But you have to accept those two things. You have to. That and the self-love that we talked about, I learned about in the Harmonic Well. Because if you don't love you, nobody else can, and that is the fact.
And
it's the same way in business, and it's the same way in health coaching, and it's the same way when I go into the schools to do my kids program on how to find a career. You know, the whole premise, like if I handed you my business for core version, the backside of it says where your thoughts grow, your life goes.
It's true.
So.
Yeah. So, can we talk about being in business with a spouse?
We can. We can. So, Sean and I are both very A-type. We're both alphas. We're both super headstrong. We're both really smart. We both always believe we're right. So, we come to the middle. But through those coming to the middles, sometimes having the blotch, you know, it's never personal. But sometimes we both take very strong stances. However, because he is the writer in our publishing company, right? So I'm the coach in Core Version. He's the writer for the publishing company, although we make all the business decisions for both companies together. I take anything he goes against in Core Version personally. He takes anything I say in Kenner Publishing personally, and we have to take a step back and say, okay, let's really talk about this, because then we'll both hit that you don't know what you're talking about, because he's the author and I'm the coach, right? So it's a lot. Like, we have to schedule that time. We have to say, okay, this week is about business, you know, every conversation is primarily going to be about business. This is just what it's going to be. And then our time can be our time. But when it's about business, it's about business. You have to separate the two. Have to.
So what are some of the projects you're working on?
So I had already decided that I really wanted to start going in a online form, you know, more so online for my coaching program. Through my kids program in the high schools, I really was like, public speaking is really what I want to do. I feel like I can touch so many more people at one time. I feel like I have a lot of really strong messages to give. I had something really great happen in my goal getters group recently. I posted a thing about letting go of relationships that don't serve you. and how choosing to stay or choosing to continue to interact or choosing to still be there, you have to take ownership of that. You have to choose when to stop allowing that to bother you and be okay with walking away if that doesn't serve you well. And somebody commented on the post and said, "You said those words with such conviction and such strength and such confidence." I said, "Wow, I can really do this." And it's that magic that happens for me that I know I need to be doing more than just this. And I mean, I've done public speaking, I've had engagements, but I need to really, so my goal is to push that on a larger platform, make connections that are gonna bring those opportunities more to the forefront and get me in front of the kind of audiences I should really be in front of because I have a message to give.
Yeah.
That piece for CoreVersion, switching to an online platform, that's what I've been working on, has not been an easy road because there's a lot of people online who sell stuff that don't really do those things or don't actually do them well. And I'm a great business person. I really have a love-hate relationship with social media. I really don't love it. I really hate it more than I love it. So it's hard for me to want to bring my platform fully there. So even though I've been doing this Goal Getters group for years, and even though prior to doing the videos, before you could do lives on Facebook, I was typing them out every day on my business page, I just really have always been like, I just want to shut all this off. So it's hard for me to fully, but I have to, because what I learned from that car accident is, when you can't physically move, if all the information was accessible online, I didn't actually have to show up to do it.
Yeah, wow, good point. Good point.
So I said, this no longer is really a choice. Mm-hmm. So I've been working on that transition. The hardest part for me is bringing that piece on to an online community, bringing the courses online, packaging them in a way that's still going to serve the way that I serve without losing the me in it. So we're working on that. And in Kenner Publishing, what we're working on is Sean's written two previous books, No More Mistakes, A Guide to Making Better Decisions, and 12 Paths to Power, The Art of Mastering Self. No More Mistakes is really for teens who are in that, you know, am I going to go right? Am I going to go left? Am I going to make these poor choices? Am I in a situation, a neighborhood, live a life that make me feel like my back is against the wall and left looks better right now because I can survive? Mm-hmm. You know, that's who that book is for. 12 Paths to Power is really for adults. I say it's probably one of the best coaching books coaches could ever use because it's like 90 pages, simple chunks. It's like pairs perfectly with any coaching program anyone would ever want to do because it's all about peeling back the layers of everything everyone ever told you you're supposed to be so you can get to who you want to be.
Mm. Is that book out yet?
It is. Mm-hmm. Okay. They're both available on Amazon. And then, you know, that's like getting to the core of you, right? So then CoreVersion was born because we take the core of you and convert it into what you really want to live, who you really want to be, what you really want to do. And the newest book that'll be coming out, which will be a new arena for him, okay? So the first two were self-help books. It's called Conversation with a Killer. It is a fictional story that takes very real things that happen in this country, all over the United States, in poor neighborhoods, you know, what were the original redlined zones, so to speak, yeah. Right? And talks about the choices that have to be made when you live in those areas. Talks about the decisions you come you come face to face with, and again, am I going left? Am I going right? Do I really have a choice?
Interesting. When will that be out?
Hopefully September. It's a huge project. So so you have to be very careful how you say things, you know, the way you lay them out. We then talk about prison, the prison system. We address that. We then talk about historical things that have happened. Psychological studies have gone into this. So it's been a lot of research. This project has been going on for years.
It's fiction.
And it's fiction. The third part is not fiction. The third part is what the history and the psychological studies come into place, but it is fiction because Shamel is the character in the story. Shamel grows up in one of these neighborhoods, has to face all these different decisions. I don't want to give too much away. And ends up going to prison and ends up getting a reversal for his life sentence. So he chooses to do this very self-discovery of how did I get here? How did we all get here? How are me and so many other black men and Hispanic men sitting in prison? And why is this even happening? And how can we change it for the generations coming up so they don't have to make these choices that we've made? You and I have talked personally before about it, about how one in five kids in the United States has had a parent in prison at some point in their lifetime. Bad enough that 5 years ago, Sesame Street released a character whose father was in prison. So when Sesame Street chooses to address the issue, there's an issue.
Yeah.
the numbers for 2014 was that one in 23 kids had a parent currently in prison in the United States. 2016, the statistic was one in 16. And we're now in 2018, so who knows what the numbers will
be. It's
going
to be lower than 16.
It's going to be lower than 16.
Wow.
So
it sounds timely, this book.
It's got to change. Prison reformation has to change. You know, in the United States, we're very focused on retribution, not rehabilitation. And that has to change because people have to reenter society, right? The other thing that has to change is the lengths of sentences, why they're happening. Preventative programs that can come into every school district. So not just the red line zones, not just the poor neighborhoods, not just the projects, but everywhere. So in the book, what's outlined is Shamel refers in the book, so Shamel's the character, he says in the book a few times, I've always been loyal to a fault, right? So the project and the solution that we're proposing in the book, Conversation with a Killer, is called the Loyalty Project, because Shamel had always been loyal to a fault, and instead we want to teach people to be loyal for the good. So the Loyalty Project is a program based that can start in kindergarten and take people all the way through 25 years of life. It's based on all these psychological studies. One thing Sean says to me all the time is, why do people have to go to prison to learn anger management? Why are we not teaching this
in school? Right.
Why are we not teaching these tactics in school? So the Loyalty Project, like I said, is kindergarten all the way through 25. It's to focus on community, focus on treatment of each other, focus on knowledge and acceptance based on information. And instead of adding to curriculum, it would hug the curriculum and be able to be a part of it. So it should be welcoming in schools. It shouldn't really cost any more money other than to train everybody. And it would change a difference, make a difference in everybody's lives.
A lot of good stuff there. Wow, sounds very exciting.
Yeah.
We can't wait, and we'll put a link on that as well.
Yeah, perfect.
Comes out. The Queen of Tough Love.
Yes.
Is that your nickname?
That is just who I am. I just say it like it is. There's really not a filter with me. I never really apologize for my words. If I said it, I meant it. I might have to apologize. You know, I always say I'm more truthful than tactful, so sometimes I might need to apologize for how I said it to you, but I meant what I said.
Do we have to be careful with our words, though?
I don't. You know, I say it all the time. Like, I have, currently I have two home organization clients, and I don't organize their houses. We go through and figure out how we even got here as we help solve the problem and then put all the tools in place so we never come back here, right? And I said, actually, I just saw my one client yesterday before I came up here, and she was telling me a story about how something happened with her boss, and I said, well, you're better than me, because I would have just said, no, no, no. It's not what we're gonna do. So I am not. I'm never intentionally hurtful. I never say anything to purposely, you know, downgrade somebody, call them names, but I mean what I say. Like, if I'm, and it always comes from a place of love and wanting you to have better, do better, be better, live better, but I'm going to shoot it straight. I'm not going to mince words. I'm not going to leave you room to wonder, what did I mean? You're going to know I meant exactly what I said.
We could use more of that in society, don't you think?
I do.
A lot of people go around the bush to get to what they're going to say, and they're afraid to be direct.
Well, and that's where passive aggressiveness comes into play. So then people walk away from situations or conversations being like, well, were they really being nasty to me? Because you weren't direct enough, so now they don't know how to take what you were trying to say, mm-hmm. right? Or when people aren't really ready to hear what you have to say, then they believe that's a personal attack. But again, we all make choices, and we can only control us. So as long as I'm clear with my delivery, and I don't do it to be hurtful, and I don't do it to be disrespectful, and it really comes from a place of empathy, but I want you to really hear what I'm saying, I'm going to say that. With my kids, I'm super strict. You know, in my household, they joke and say I'm the dictator, that Sean's the negotiator. So they will go to him, especially when they were younger, they would go to him and be like, can you veto what mom said because it's not fair? You know, my kids, I believe we are creating entitled children who think they're just supposed to have things. Everything happens instantaneously. You know, with the internet, it is what it is. You can't really stop instant gratification in this society. However, you can control the entitlement. And I feel like that's missing. My kids, when I say no, I mean no. I'm not going to negotiate. I'm not going to go back. I'm not then all of a sudden going to give you the cake when you didn't do what I wanted you to do. I don't care how many times you ask me. My kids didn't get birthday gifts or Christmas gifts if their grades weren't what I expect, because no different than when you leave my house and you have to live in the real world. You have to show up to work. You have to do what you're supposed to do in order to make the money you want to make. And if you don't show up and you don't do the things you're supposed to do, you can't afford the cable, and you can't afford the game, and you can't afford 55 pairs of Jordans and a cell phone and whatever else it is that you want to walk around with.
We need more of this.
Right. So that's why I say I'm the queen of tough love. Or like my girlfriend that I said would walk around the corner, she said, I used to take a deep breath and be like, I really need to hear this though, so I'm going to go around. Go around there, because she was, you know, I'm like, why? But why? Why? Why are we doing this?
Have you always been that way?
Yeah. I think I've always been that way. I just wasn't strong enough in my own truth to necessarily be that way without being disrespectful.
But I definitely feel and see the confidence.
Mm-hmm.
You're confident in your ability. You're confident in your message.
Yes.
Because obviously you've been successful with it.
Right. And people either love me or hate me, and I'm okay with it. They either really, really like me or they really, really don't, but they all respect me, and I can live with that.
Cool. Important life lessons.
Mm-hmm.
You have a list of 100 goals?
List of 100 goals, yes. So when I was doing the body shop at home, I went to my first conference. Anybody who does, what is it? Now they call it multi-level marketing, right? Okay. So, you know, we changed the names of things so people are more comfortable with them. So when I went to my first conference for the body shop at home, I was in a room and a woman got up and spoke, and she had been a mom who was a single mom about to lose her house. And she was like, I either make this business work because her husband left her, or we're going to be homeless. And that's when she's the one who taught this lesson on a list of 100 goals. Now I'm clear that it's really about mindset. However, it's a functional tool that I use with all my clients. I talk about it in my goal getters group. A list of 100 goals. So I say to you, Roger, you got to write a list of 100 goals. And you might go, 100 goals? Can't accomplish 100 goals, right? You're like, it's an impossible task. So your mind immediately starts to close off like, I don't know what you're expecting from me. But if I say to you, well, let's say you were like, I want to create this show, American Real. And I say, that's great. What are the steps to get there? Well, first I have to do this, and then I have to do this. And now you've listed 20 things. So now you have 21 goals. And you give them all timelines. But what's beautiful about the list of 100 is, let's say you said, I want to lose 20 pounds in 2 months, and you don't quite hit that 2-month mark, but you're 3 pounds or 5 pounds away, you just extend it a little bit. It's not so set in stone.
It's flexible.
It's flexible. The point is to focus on accomplishing the goals and actually finishing them. And then you're supposed to go back, and when you start it, you number in a book, whether you skip every other line, but you number 1 to 100. You don't have to sit and write it all at one time, but you're supposed to keep going back, and every time you think of something new you want to try, new you want to do, new you want to learn, you add to this list.
Is this your concept?
No. It's this woman's concept that was at the thing. And you go back, and then you cross them off.
And then you
add a
new
one? And you watch pages start to fill. And then when you finish that 100, you start a new 100.
Got it.
So I'm on my fourth 100 list of 100 goals.
I'm going to try it.
Yes, please do. I'd love to know how it goes.
I love it.
And don't count out any of the small ones. Like if you want to take a multivitamin and you don't, that's a goal. I'm going to take a vitamin every day this week. I'm going to take a vitamin every day for 2 weeks. I'm going to take a vitamin every day for 3 weeks.
And what's the lesson there? These little goals lead to success?
Bigger. Yes. Consistency.
Mm-hmm.
Let me focus on the little pieces to get to the big pieces. You know, when you were little and you built Legos, you had to start with a base, right? You had to build the base. And then you could add to that.
Right. It's a great approach. What do you mean by book the magic?
Oh, the book, the magic. So from The Secret, the book, The Magic, it's 28 days of practices. And I swear by it, I live by it, I read it every morning, I have for years. I start my day with that. There's little practices in it, right? So there's little things. As much as, you know, you're supposed, like the first day, you write down 5 things you're grateful for. I'm so happy and grateful for such and such because such and such. So you have to give a why, who, what, who you're grateful for and why.
Okay.
And then the next day, maybe you're grateful for your health, so you write that on a piece of paper and you carry it with you, and throughout the day you say, I'm so very happy and grateful for my health. And then maybe another day, one of the other practices in it is you literally, every single step you take, every time your foot hit the ground, you say, thank you, thank you, thank you. Because we don't appreciate our body. We don't appreciate the fact I can take these steps. I'm moving forward, I'm going. Be grateful for everything. And so I love the practices in it. If ever you're having a really rough day, I promise you, if you pulled out that book in the middle of the day and said, I got to reset, I got to refocus, I got to get back to the good and stop feeling the aggravation I'm feeling, that book will bring you there.
And it's called The Magic.
It's called The Magic.
Great. Wow, we're learning lots of new things today.
Yeah.
Why do you like helping people?
When somebody says to me, because of you, I believed I could do it, and this wouldn't have happened if I hadn't met you, that is magical for me. That is the pay.
So how does that make you feel?
It warm, filled with life, love, happiness, filled with purpose. Knowing that everything I went through, everything I had to learn, all the tough lessons I had to crawl through were all worth it if somebody else is able to say, I changed this because you made me believe I could.
So let's talk about the importance of using kids' strengths to help them discover their pursuit and passion.
Mm-hmm. So... I talk about how when I'm young that I didn't want anyone to tell me what to do. I didn't want to be told no, right? So I never wanted to be told what to do, and I never wanted to be told no. That's a strength. As a parent, as an adult, we're like, if you don't go do what I told you to do,
right,
it's aggravating to us, right? Or the kid maybe who can't sit still but can put together a model while standing up without looking at instructions. That's a skill, but we don't look at it like that. All we see is the frustration and the aggravating we're feeling because they're not doing what we want them to do in the time we want them to do it. Now, don't get me wrong. Yes, we need structure. Yes, we need this. Yes, we need that. But like, in addition to the program that I do in the high schools, I also get brought into college courses for people who are doing like continuing ed, who have to do the so many credits, like as a teacher, get the special ed piece, you know, whatever. I'll go into those courses and I tell them, The number one thing is your classroom should be treated like your house, and these are guests at your house.
Where'd that come from?
From issues with my own kids going through things, and they do a lot of your kid, but you're there. Like, you know, I always told my kids when they went to school that their teachers were their parents, and they had to give them the same respect they give me. But if I send them into your room, and now you're degrading them, and tell them they don't know how to listen, and tell, you know, and you're not paying attention or trying to find out why the behavior is happening, because every behavior serves a purpose. When you're five and you don't know how to say, well, he stinks, so I don't want to sit next to him, so I sit in my cubby because you always make me sit next to Johnny, because we don't give them the confidence or we don't give them the skills to deal with social unhappiness yet, right? Now they're the problem. But as the adult, we're the problem.
How's it going?
That approach?
Yeah, with the teachers.
So there's always a couple who are resistive, and those are the couple that teach kids because they chose that career, because of the schedule. They're not really there because they want to help, they want to change, they want to... Happens. You know, there's people in all kinds of careers that they did because their parents thought it was a good idea. Somebody said, oh, this is good because of this, but it wasn't necessarily what they really wanted to do, who they really are, et cetera, right? But usually people are like, that's so great. As, you know, and I say things as simple as make sure you know how to say everybody's name. Because if I came to your house every day and every day you call attendance and every day you say my name wrong, I think you don't care about me.
Wow. It's powerful. And it's such a small thing,
It's a small
right?
thing, but it happens all the time.
Sure.
Or don't stand in the room and talk about the principal, other teachers, another kid with a teacher in the room so we can hear you. You know how many times my kids come home and say, well, they were talking about the principal, or she was talking about this kid.
Not good.
I let a homeroom teacher have it when my daughter was in seventh grade. She called me to say, we need to talk about your daughter. And I said, I'm so happy you called me. I was just going to call you. I heard you were talking about my daughter in the room in front of everybody with another teacher. Is that right? She was like,
Yeah, and it's amazing because I would think that a very high percentage of teachers are not looking at it this way.
They're not.
Right.
And with social media, they get on their phones in class.
Mm-hmm.
And I just, I love technology. So I don't want anyone to think that I appreciate the fact I have a cell phone. I appreciate the fact my wrist will buzz when a call is coming. I appreciate all of that. However, I think there's a time and a place for it. And I think because of the instant gratification, we've stopped setting the examples we want to get back, right? We're not as engaged, just as much as they're not as engaged. So you have to make it a more homey environment, right? And the kind where we sit down and have dinner together, and the kind where we discuss things together, and the kind where we're interactive and we care if somebody is having a bad day.
What does the administration think of this approach?
Well, in those courses, when I go into the, some of them are like head of their department or whatever, and they're like, wow, I didn't really, they were like, you know what, you're right. Or they'll say, well, you know, we're supposed to meet all these test scores and we're supposed to hit all these marks and we're supposed to do all these things. How do I make that happen? And they're sending me kids who don't have a ninth grade math level and they have a fourth grade math level. I said, do you know what schools that's an issue? Do you know, have you identified what buildings that you specifically, she said, absolutely. I said, so create a Bridge the Gap program. Have your juniors and seniors who need volunteer hours anyway, who are your honor students, who are definitely going to college, partner with these kids who don't have parents at home, create an after-school program that's free because you have volunteers, you or somebody else in one of your departments who's having an issue with your kids reaching your scores because it only benefits everybody, so you each pick a different day to volunteer and oversee maybe, provide a snack, you can get a grant for that, provide a snack to these kids, have them come over from the middle school, it'll introduce them to the high school, and bridge the gap. Now they're sitting with a kid who's going to go to college, maybe they're not saying that at home. They're going to be brought up to speed because now they're having help. use the sources you have instead of looking at what you don't.
Yeah, and I could see how all your organization skills, your system skills come into action.
Everywhere.
And it seems so simple when you say this. It's like, oh, why didn't I think of that? And
right.
I'm sure the teachers are doing the same thing. And are you seeing some success stories where
absolutely.
Some of your practices are now taking place and working within the school system?
Yes, absolutely. And then like those same schools will do Sean the book, No More Mistakes. They'll have those for those kids who are facing those crossroads, who, you know, guidance counselors are taking the books. And so once Conversation with the Killer comes out, we're looking at those college courses that we partner with to maybe offer a package for all three, because we think that maybe there's a place for each of those.
Awesome.
Within
awesome.
The buildings.
Well, look, Sarah, we could sit here and talk all day.
Right.
This is great. I've learned so much today about you, about your background and your wonderful story.
Thank
and
you.
You're helping people, which is that's why we're here. I really believe that. So
I just always want to give people the help I didn't get, or, you know, save them from mistakes I've already made.
Yeah. But before I let you go,
yes.
One last question that mm-hmm. I ask every guest, and that's, what do you want your legacy to be?
What do I want my legacy to be? I would like to leave a few major corporations. We have some other big things in the works that we're working on that have nothing to do with coaching and publishing, for my children and their families, that everybody can exist for many generations on. But more importantly than that, I would really like to promote people helping each other, people being more accountable, people learning that they do have choices, people picking careers that they want instead of they're told to have, helping guidance counselors fix this before they go to college, right? Make sure they're really on the right path and not because of some test they took online that told them they're an EFGC and whatever else, so they should be a scientist, but they're horrible at math. That's what I would like to leave.
Awesome. And I know with our academy, mm-hmm. you have expressed some interest, and we would really love to welcome you into our academy as an instructor, because I think there's a lot that you could do to help some of the folks that are connected to America Real. So I hope we can make that happen as a goal. We'll put that as one of our 100.
Yes, absolutely. I would love to be part of American Reels Academy. I love what you do here, and the fact that, you know, everyone is unique and have a story. It fits right in with everything I believe. So I'm excited to
awesome.
Be an instructor at the Academy.
Awesome. Well, thanks for making the trip. We're going to have fun tonight
yes.
at the anniversary party.
Yes, the 1-year anniversary.
Yes.
So now this is really officially season 2, right?
That's right. And you were our last guest before that anniversary. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Roger. I'm so glad.
Appreciate it.
Thanks for tuning into American Real. Be sure to visit our website, AmericanReal.tv. Or search for us on iTunes or YouTube for past episodes. While you're there, please rate us or leave us a review, as that helps others find our show. I am truly grateful and appreciate all of your support. At American Real, we're on a mission to help as many people around the world fulfill their dreams and obtain their goals. If you'd like to be part of our inner circle or want one-on-one coaching, check out the American Real Learning Academy, where we have self-help groups and courses so you can build the best you. We also have a new Facebook group where you can connect with high achievers from around the world. If you want to go even further, maybe you're determined to write your own book or launch your own podcast, contact me today to see if we could help. You can reach me through Instagram or Facebook, or email me directly at roger@americanreal.tv. And speaking of podcasting, our next course will be starting soon. So, if you're interested in launching your own podcast, join me at Podcast Your Passion. I'll take you through my 8-week course where I'll mentor you to build a world-class podcast. I'm only taking on a small group of people who want to share their passion through broadcasting, where I'll have you up on iTunes and YouTube within weeks so you can podcast your passion. Click on the link below for more information. Thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you next week.